not the world's issue to have. It's not very often I get called in a meeting, and there isn't. So I'm doing that here because there isn't a chair in place. Some places still have a gavel evening committee meeting, because I missed the opportunity to go with that. Some small pleasures as well. Members, I'm opening the meeting because this is a committee of council that currently does not have a chair, and so I step up as a clerk and invite you to nominate a member as a chair.
I'd like to nominate Adrian Jones, please.
Second. Any other nominations? Thank you, Chair. Thank you to you. The members in the
is this a permanent elevation, or is it a meeting by meeting?
No, this is for the year.
Well, I wish I'd do that for you.
Thank you for checking. I wasn't sure there was a... Thank you very much for nominating me to the chair. And first of all, I'd like to, in particular, welcome the newly elected members, which of course are Jenny, Johnson, and Mike, who I'm forever grateful for helping me when I was terribly disabled, when it changed my wheel in the country. To the code of conduct. Members are asked to consider whether they have any disclosable, pecuniary, and/or other relevant interest in connection with any of the items on this agenda, and if so, to declare and state the nature of the interest. Jeff?
Yeah, just as a personal interest.
Go into the report in any further detail. I need to open by employee's superannuation or conditions of service or to the conduct of any person employed by the council, that question shall not be discussed until the council committee has decided whether or not to bring into play the power of exclusion of public press. This report, in accordance with that, to allow you to do that to its fullest extent, should have been a private report. I have apologised to the officers concerned, and I make this apology to you. I don't have any excuse. This didn't go through the normal procedures for quality assurance to, as this was to get this committee to meet as quickly as possible, and so things were rushed through.
Well, I'm sure the apology is accepted in the good management sense meant.
Chairman, in the spirit of that, obviously if members feel at all that either the whole of this meeting or any part of it would go into a discussion that should be an exempt, then I would invite them to the session.
Yeah, I think what I would say is I think it's put the individuals in an invidious position. So, not so much because it's an open report, so I'm fairly sure that we would have wanted it to be an exemption to be lifted for it to be discussed in these sort of matters, salaries, chief officers and so on. I'm sure we would want it to be in secret, and in fact the more transparency the better. My concern is that the chief executive took his, whether he took it upon himself or he took it by advice, to put in a note to all members of staff that he was leaving, that the whole store was taken over, and a range of other things. Now, somebody, a lawyer, no doubt, might say, well, after, if you like, the whole thing is said, this is what I'm recommending. But I didn't actually even say it puts everyone in a kind of busiest position. And I personally would have preferred, as a member of this committee, if this committee had the opportunity to see this report and may take a judgment on it before it was given to our staff to suggest that this is what's going to happen. Because if this doesn't happen, the staff will say, well, what the hell's going on? Why we were told this and now this is happening? So I think it puts this committee, it puts the current chief executive and anyone who is subsequently adjusted because of that in a really invidious position. And I think that's my concern about it. I believe in openness and transparency, so I welcome the fact that this is not public. But I think what was done was, has put this committee, it was a bit actually disrespectful to this committee, in my opinion.
Chair, I fully accept that. I note that those were the logical conclusions, because once this wasn't an exempt, there was a logical train of events that said staff should see this intention from the chief exec rather than picking up through some gossip or element of the website, because not everyone will make it their business to read the papers of this committee. I accept that's the logical outcome. I accept everything that you just said and take responsibility. And put in place whatever I can to ensure it doesn't happen again. So, as I said, I apologise to you as well as to those officers.
The suggested adoption of the course of action was overturned.
say, I mean, I spoke to Leslie on that day. I didn't know that until you showed me the exact view.
If we want to proceed, I'm not really sure that we want to.
Thank you, Chair. I would just
to have some clarification, if I may. I was of the understanding that the disclosure and borrowing services have actually announced this at 12 noon on the day, causing some of the rush that had to happen. I would just like some clarification on that, please.
We'll make this point because, if I may, Chair, I didn't know about that news. That is new information, as far as I'm concerned, that it did appear. But there's nothing wrong with the reports. There's nothing wrong with the recommendations. There's nothing wrong with the report. The issue was that someone saw fit to send something out towards staff before even the members of this committee actually being consulted and had an opportunity to recommend. Now, because I like to think a fair-minded person, I'm going to, as an individual, I did feel disrespected as a member of this committee, but I'm prepared to accept Ms. McCall's apology. But what I want real reassurance, and maybe you went some way towards that for when you respond to another question, is that this isn't a cultural issue which says the chief executive and the head of law and government or whatever, will just do what they like without thinking about the fact that actually it is members who ultimately accept the accountability for the decisions that are being made, and therefore it would be right to speak to the members of this committee prior to issuing the note that went out to all members of staff. That's my That's the reassurance and assurance, Chair, that I accept. Mr. McCall's made a very full apology, even followed his own standing orders, but it's a cultural issue to me. Who is it that runs the authority? And where does respect lie in terms of the role of committee members and the role of a chief executive or head of law that wants to get a quick message out before anyone reads about it from the bar of service?
Just very quickly, I think the point that really rang with myself and I know other members, particularly of our group, was the fact that the date was announced by the chief executive as to when he was going. And as far as I was concerned, and the only way I could advise our members when they were saying, well, what is his, what are the terms of his contract? And clearly, when I was telling members, well, clearly it is a 3 months' notice unless that's mutually agreed by the officer and the leadership of this council. So, there was no explanation as to why he was going on the 28th of July and why he wasn't sending out his statutory 3 months' notice. And it leaves us as members in a very difficult position, not only with our own members to give an explanation, but also the members of the public who say, well, in a job like that, doesn't he have to give 3 months' notice? And then it is out in the public domain that he's going on the 28th of July.
Phil's complete apology here today.
can explain it if we need to.
Pat, I really think at this stage, I'd ask you to withhold that thing.
So, moving on to the report, Chair.
This is where I get the chance for you then.
Yeah.
You have four recommendations before you, each dealing with, in effect, a separate topic. So, one suggestion perhaps is you might like to debate and determine them one at a time, or would you want it all in one go?
Oh, let's see them one at a time. I won't think.
So the first issue, Chair, is that on the 28th, Mr. Robinson handed in his formal resignation from his post. Some of us were aware beforehand, but in private, because given the nature of his role, it's subject to the state's announcement, and so his new role was embargoed. As said, he was informed on the morning of the 28th that the Secretary of State was about to make the announcement that he was being appointed to the new role of his new role of Chief Executive for the Disclosure and Barring Service, and so had to act quite quickly. It being half term, there was an element of actually who's here to keep things up. And also quite quickly discussion over when he should start and finish here, and so there was a discussion with the leader, I understand, and I was asked to arrange this committee at the earliest possible opportunity for you as members to consider his request to leave after 2 months rather than on 3 months' notice for him to start up his new role and take into account the 11 days of leave that he has to take. The information is in there as to, and for you to determine whether that's an appropriate amount of time given HR advice as to be able to hand over. Deal with what he needs to deal with, but also meet the requirements of the, his new employees. Jeff?
Yeah, I'm obviously has got a number of points on this. I suppose my question would be, I don't think we have it both ways. Privately, it was urgent, so, and there was no idea somebody out. And B, that somehow the Secretary of State was going to make the announcement. Clearly, someone will have to agree. The chief, the Secretary of State wanted to make the announcement in light of the date that Eric gave them. Now, Eric must have said when he went for that job, and they would ask him, what is your notice period? He would have said, it's 3 months.
Oh, no, my apologies, Chair. Those are two distinct issues. So, the announcement of the Secretary of State was the trigger point for Eric handing in his notice. But the Secretary of State's announcement said sometime in late summer, so that didn't talk about the date. His request is based on a separate conversation he's had with his new employers. That was merely the trigger date for us all to action.
So let's not speculate.
That's useful, because this is information that's not in the report, but came out because someone needs to make a point. My issue is, Eric must have given, when asked, what is your notice period, must have said 3 months. Because that's what he's contracted for, that's why we pay him a salary, because it's part of his terms and conditions. So, my question is, who suddenly, because this is what's in the report, says something that's down to 2 months? Why? Why didn't he just work out, as he would have told his own clerk, it's 3 months' notice? So why don't change?
That's a conversation that would be very difficult for us to have.
That's it. I think the leader wanted to try and add to the information.
You stop me saying it.
Try again.
Only until this point.
Decided to take up and he was submitting his resignation, and I accept it. As I can, as leader, his resignation. There was then, which we alluded to, a conversation about Lehman dates, yeah? And he offered his view. I made a call on what I felt was an appropriate notice period. I made a judgment call that while it was important that I handed over the period, sooner rather than later. You should also remember a couple of days later, obviously, yeah, Deputy Group Leader was involved, yeah, in that discussion we had, yeah, about the next stages of the process with that report that went to us, yeah, and we received that report and proposals we recall from officers. And I believe at the time, because let me say otherwise, we were all comfortable with that. Well, at that level, nobody could say otherwise. Obviously, you're on your head, you're thinking different. Essentially, anyway, coming to the point, yeah, the call I made was that a 2-month notice period was better for us, just in my view, than a 3-month period. And obviously, you may disagree with that, but I'm not convinced it's a massive problem, to be quite honest with you. I'm less convinced it should lead to us disagreeing on what the format points of us would be like here today. And I do think the bottom line is, for the sake of the organisation, sooner rather than later, we need to move on with the situation. You know, and somebody in place, like Paul Sutton.
So at that point, but that's a short decision.
Yeah.
So that's an incident.
That's what happened. I'll be honest with you.
Were you happy with that?
Yes.
Or less than you want to say?
Yeah, I just wanted to make a point on that, really. I think there's some confusion into the role, really, of the committee or the get-together that we decided on where the party leaders and deputies would meet on a regular basis. And, you know, that's sort of the discussion at another place, whether that continues at the moment. But clearly, there's no decisions that can be made at those committees. It's just a sounding board, really. It has no jurisdiction. It's a committee which we hope, you know, where we can all be, trust each other and we can have an open discussion. Yeah. It's not really for anybody to go away from that. I'm sorry if you got the impression that you could go away from that with a view that would be supported by all. But we'll leave that one there for the moment. I mean, my question on this is, if Mr. Robinson is going, as indicated, he's going on the 28th, why can't he go with immediate effect from now? Why can his termination not
be immediate effect? Well, if I may look at it, I think it's pretty obvious that would cause a huge quantity of rapid reorganisation. Anita?
Yeah, I was just really going to comment on Leslie's comment, really, that, you know, I think it would be good practice to have a handover situation. You know, this has come sort of like a bit of a bolt out of the blue. I just think it would be prudent to have that handover period. I think Paul has probably acted to some degree as his right-hand man, and it probably...
Don't damn him so early,
please. probably a good reason, really, why he's been put forward for this position, but, I do think that we should have at least some meeting period. Because Paul Sutton has been covering a number of functions where there's a position left empty as well, so I think it would unduly put pressure on him.
I'm only to give advice on that as a proposal. So two elements to it, contractual and local government. In local government terms, then the council must have a head of paid service. Not having a head of paid service obviously invites challenge from central government. The earliest point with which a new head of paid service can be appointed is the 15th of July full council. That said, I'm well aware of councils that if they have a recommendation would go forward for a week or three second point obviously is contractual, so as it stands, Eric is entitled to demand his 3 months notice in the same way as the councillor is entitled to demand those 3 months notice of him. However, there is nothing to stop this committee going back and saying actually the request is unacceptable to us and here is a counter proposal.
I mean, I need to agree with what Anita has just said around the handover period. I mean, I've worked with Paul now for, you know, since he's been here, I've worked 2 months with him. And he's really capable, great person to work with, but I think he deserves, we have to use his person, sure, that he's got some kind of efficient handover to him. I'm a bit confused as we've gone from why isn't Eric serving 3 months to he can go now, why can't he go now? So there's a bit of a contradiction going on here. And also it comes across as being a little bit pure, so yeah, he can go now if you want to. I think we need him to stay in order to ensure an effective handover to whoever his successor is. We're all saying the post 12 is hopefully that person. But we need to ensure that the handover takes place in a manner that suits his successor. And that would not certainly have been the case if we were to say to Eric,
a little bit childish, actually, because we're not happy with the situation.
I'd rather thought
it was going to cover that. Jeff? Yeah, a couple of things. If that is the case, then it was maybe.
Jeff means the 15th.
The 15th, sorry. I heard the 18th. So that's the next count.
council performance manages the chief executive and is the chief executive's manager on a day-to-day basis. I think sometimes in that process it gets forgotten that it's actually this committee that makes those harder decisions on hiring and firing and termination. So I think it's got caught up in those conversations. Your second point is part of that wider debate that's going on. Listen to these comments on that.
Anita.
Okay, I was just going to comment on the point that you just made it in terms of we've got annual leave to take as well. And if we look at the 15th of July, minus 11 days annual leave, it doesn't give us an awful lot of time for handover. So I wouldn't support that.
Okay. Is there anything else?
Take a good 9 months to come back to this committee with a proposal as to